So, hello, welcome back. Today another episode about the Blue Note Classic Series. It's the third round already, and as promised, they keep coming, the big guns. Marvelous, great titles. Let's go quick through the titles which have been out there already. They have brought out the Horace Silver Quintet, Song for My Father. Then we have Wayne Shorter, Speak No Evil. We have, Lee Morgan, The Sidewinder. And we have The Real McCoy, McCoy Tyner, which are all, of course, classics. So the title of the series is well put. This is the series where the Blue Note label puts out their classic, iconic, most known releases. Today we are talking about Joe Henderson's Page One and Cannonball Adderley, Something Else. Those are the two titles we are talking about today. From the Joe Henderson, I have the 45 round per minute analog production, and the Cannonball Adderley I can compare with the Music Matter, both versions, the 33 and a third, and the 33 and a third SRX version. So, and now after six releases at the end, we can do a short resume about our experience, or my experience, with the series so far. So let's start with a comparison of Joe Henderson Page One. On the left is the analog production, on my right is the classic series release from Blue Note. Page One originally came out in 1963 and has Kenny Dorn on the trumpet, Joe Henderson on the tenor sax, McCoy Tyner on the piano, Butch Warren on the bass, and Pete LaRocca on the drums. The 45 round per minute analog production was released in 2009. To my knowledge, both versions have been mastered by Kevin Gray. Same data, of course, for the classic series from Blue Note, with one thing, that this one came out in 2021. So we're talking 12 years later here, which is, of course, worth mentioning due to maybe tape deterioration or kind of something like that. So I compared both of them, and I have a clear winner. Let's start with the Blue Note. The Blue Note has a beautiful soundstage. Everything is where it should be. My copy has some distortions on the first song on Blue Bossa, which made me return it. So don't talk about that. Those things can happen. They will return me, give me another copy. So don't put that part into the equation. Otherwise, it's a very flat, clean copy. No other problems aside that on the first song. Beautiful soundstage, very analytic in a way. It almost sounds as if I have changed my copper cables to silver cables, which I haven't done. It's very, very punchy, in a good and in a not so good way. But we are talking about a very good sounding record. And never forget that. We are talking about regular priced releases. In Germany we have to pay 22 euros, which is incredible fair if you consider the amount of work, the amount of effort they put into these releases. The analog production, 45 round per minute, sounds better. Why? What is the difference? The difference is that somehow it's more analog. Sounds say very warm, still analytic, still very dynamic, lot of punch, much detail. And the biggest difference for me was the sound stage, the separation of the instruments, the depth of the sound stage. You simply have more room on the analog production and an overall more analog feeling. I know it's difficult to talk about feelings as a male, but it has this analog, it has this touch of grandeur more than the classic series. So there is a big difference when it comes to soundstage separation and depth of the performance. So if you aim for the best sounding version, you probably still have to hunt down these analog production 45s. Some of them are still in print, are still available. I don't think that they will be for long, but they are still there. If you say this is an important record, I want a very good sounding edition, then get this. You will be happy. It's a great, great album and a great, great edition. Although not the best sounding, the best sounding available pressing. But still, never forget that they are much, much cheaper than for example, the analog productions with go initially for $55. So the next one is something else, Cannonball Adderley. Here we have the classic series cover. Here we have the SRX version from Music Matters, and the main difference next to the pressing are the Stoughton covers with the much talked about session photos. Cover is quite different, of course. When it comes to this album, this something else, the main datas are, it has been recorded and originally came out in 1958, 1 year before it did Kind of Blue. The musicians are Miles Davis on trumpet, Cannonball Adderley on alto sax, Hank Jones on the piano, Sam Jones on bass, and Art Blakey on drums. And this is, of course, for the most part, a Miles Davis album. No need to discuss that. Okay, once more. Let's start with the classic series edition. Same here. Very analytic, very punchy, clear, good soundstage. You have good separation from the instruments. You have dead flat, very silent vinyl. It's unbelievable what they give us for 22 euros, $25, I don't know, maybe you even get them sometimes cheaper in the United States. That's a great job they have done over there. And also here, the 33 and a third edition, the SRX, more, a tad more of everything. Plus, again, more the touch of the analog, more soundstage, more details, more it breathes more. You have more depth. It's the same astonishing, it's very astonishing. Same effect we have with the Joe Henderson, page one, and the classic and analog productions. They do not sound digital. I don't want to go that far, please. Don't put it in that way. But you have here more time for more breathing, more of everything. I want to have more warmth, more depth, more soundstage, more 3D, and up tempo. It's again, that's sometimes like dancing your name. I know it's very difficult to describe because those are all fantastic recordings, and we are talking about the last 10%. And that's what I find with the SRX and with the regular 33 and a third, which is here. Also, this one is slightly better than the classic. So, and that now points into my resume for the first six releases from the classic series, because it in a way has all been the same. All are very, very, very good releases from the classic series, but they are not the best sounding out there. They are the price value winners in a way, which is of course a very, very good thing. But I remember when the series was announced, there has been not few people who said those classic series will sound even better than the analog production or the Music Matters. Made 33 and a third or 45, because Kevin Gray upgraded his mastering equipment, and you will hear that. And I don't. As simple as that. I hear differences. It's, as I said, sharper, director, that was a German word, sorry. I don't know the English. But I don't hear how it is better. It's different. But I sometimes said it, different is not always better. But maybe I'm too conservative to acknowledge that. For me, the analog productions and the Music Matter still sounds better. That's my resume of the first six. But don't get me wrong, this classic series is a fantastic thing. It's great that they put them out in this price range. Chapeau Blue Note, please keep them coming, and they will keep them coming, because this albums, this editions, they has to be available, and not like with the Music Matters SRX, you have to pay incredible prices, insane, ridiculous prices. That's not what those albums, those important releases are meant for. They have to be available, they have to be out there, and in this way, in this manner, Blue Note makes a fantastic job, and it's great that they keep them coming, two records per month, plus the Blue Note series, that's quite some output. I really enjoy it, and every month when the Blue Note delivery comes, either Tone Poet or Classics, I'm always excited, and they never ever disappointed me, and that's not easy. So great job. Thank you, Blue Note, and thank you for your time. See you. Bye.